So good evening to all of you. Now let us start our discussion. Okay, so let us continue our discussion. All of you, voice?
Yes, sir.
Screen is also visible. Okay, so if you recall, in previous class we discussed about the carrier concentration in semiconductor, considering the semiconductor was in thermal equilibrium or in non-thermal equilibrium case. So in thermal equilibrium, you saw that the carrier concentration NNP can be computed in terms of intrinsic carrier concentration Ni and the position of the Fermi level from the with respect to the intrinsic Fermi level. So for the semiconductor which was not in thermal equilibrium, we discussed that we should define two different Fermi levels, two different Fermi levels for electron and holes, and the two Fermi levels are known as quasi Fermi levels, EFN and EFP, for the electrons and holes respectively. Okay. So having discussed the carrier concentration in semiconductor, now it's time to discuss about the contact potential. This class will try to cover two topics. We'll discuss the review the contact potential, and also we'll talk about the carrier transport in the semiconductor in very brief. As I said that I'm reviewing the basic of semiconductor, not going into deep, but I'm just going to introduce the concept and give you some basic equations that could be useful for all of you later on. Okay, so let us talk a little bit about the contact potential. You see that contact is very, very important. Contacts are present in all the semiconductor devices. Okay, even if it is a, let's say, simply a metal semiconductor contact, Schottky diode, then there will be two different layers on top of semiconductor. Metal can be grown, so there is a metal semiconductor. Okay, to take a connection from the outside world. Basically, we need to have metal contact, a metal wire. So that should be coming out from so you can see that I was telling that the contacts are very important, because all the semiconductor devices will have some sort of contact. It could be an ohmic contact or rectifying contact, or it could be an ohmic contact where current can flow in both directions, or it could be a rectifying contact where the current will flow only in one direction. Okay, so in PN junction, even you see that in PN junction diode, what you have that there are two regions. One is P-type semiconductor, junction of P-type semiconductor and N-type semiconductor, and then there will be metallic wires coming out from the P region and N region. So here again, there will be a metal semiconductor contact. Another metal semiconductor contact will be here. Okay. And one junction here, the semiconductor contact is at this point, one metal semiconductor contact is at this point, one metal semiconductor contact is at this point. Similarly, in metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistors, there will be a source contact, okay, which provides the source terminal, drain contact. So there will be a drain terminal here associated, and on the top up you see that gate, basically one more gate contact must be coming out. Okay, so there are different contacts in a semiconductor. It could be a metal contact, sometime it could be metal semiconductor contact, or it could be semiconductor contact. So let us see how to characterize the property of a contact. Okay, I'm going to just put here a very general discussion. What I am considering here that the two materials here are brought in close contact. Okay, so one material is M1, another one is M2. So both could be silicon, both could be one could be N-type silicon, another one could be P-type silicon. So in junction here, or one could be a metal, another could be silicon, so it could be a metal semiconductor contact, or both could be metal with different work functions. So we'll see what will happen if using the two separate materials. You see that the two materials have two different work functions. So let's say that the Fermi level is higher, at higher level in this metal compared to this metal. So what will happen? The carriers will move from higher energy level to lower energy level. So this is a metal, plenty of electrons are here, metal, but the carriers here are at the higher energy level compared to this carriers in this region. So what will happen as a result? Some electrons will start when the junction is made. And also let us say that at the same time one hypothetical contact is made here. Okay, so time we can say that the electrons will start moving from metal M1 to metal M2. A carrier, let's say that this is metal, so the carriers are electron. So when the electrons will leave this metal one, reaches to metal 2, so metal 1 becomes positive because negative carriers have migrated from this region and they are accumulated to this to metal M2. So this will be relatively at the higher potential compared to this, and you will see that when the carrier starts migrating, this migration will not go forever, because when the carriers will move from one side to one side, and electric field one side to another side, electric field is also established like this. Okay, so see, look at this electric line. Then what will happen to this? Then the further movement of the carriers from M1 to M2 will be subject to this electric field. This electric field strength will keep on increasing with time. And a time will come when the electric field will be so strong that it won't allow carriers move from region M1 to M2. and an equilibrium is established. So once the equilibrium is established, then even at that time, the region M1 will be positively charged, you can say, region M2 will be negatively charged, and therefore there will be a potential difference created across the junction. For this case, when we are considering that electrons are moving from M1 to M2, and as a result, you see that this kind of potential profile will be built here. You can see that there is a change in the potential, and the left side will be at the higher potential, and the right side will be at the lower potential. So a potential difference is created. So this potential difference, the change in the potential when we move from region M1 to M2, this can be, this is actually noted as the contact potential, and we note it as a phi M1, M2. We'll note this contact potential as, you can see here, as phi M1, M2. So phi M1, M2 is the contact potential, change in the potential when someone move from M1 to M2. Okay, from M1 to M2, the change in the potential is phi M1 M2, which is also noted as a contact. There is a contact potential. Okay, if the two materials are not having, if the energy level in the two materials are not at the same level. Okay, if the two materials have two, let's say that the two materials are two metals. So if the two metals are having the same work function, then of course the carriers will be at the same energy level in the two materials. So no carrier moment, no waiting potential will be formed. Okay, but as far if there is a work function difference, function of the two materials are different, then definitely a contact potential is set up at the junction. Okay. We will take a particular case here, and we will see that how we can look into how we can explore this concept further. Okay, so here I am considering the two cases. Okay, so one case I am considering the two material. The Fermi levels of two material will be aligned, because after the steady state, okay, there will not be any flow of the current. So if there is no flow of the current, the two Fermi levels will align to each other. At the same time, what will happen? Carriers, as I discussed earlier, carrier will be moving from region M2. So material M1 becomes positively charged, M2 becomes negatively charged. And therefore, as a result, you will see that this kind of potential, contact potential, the potential is formed at, the potential will vary across the junction like this. Okay, and there is a potential change at the junction here. So this potential change is basically nothing but the contact potential phi M1. And this is defined as the work function of metal 2 minus work function of metal 1. Okay. Find as a work function of metal 2 minus work function of metal 1. So the contact potential moving from M1 to M2. Okay, when we move from M1 to M2, we'll see that when carriers will basically move from M1 to M2, they will see this potential difference, phi W M2 minus M1. Okay, so work function of the second material minus the work function of the first material when we move from 1 to 2, metal material M1 to material M2. And therefore the potential graph will be like this. And as a result, the energy graph is just a inverted version of this potential. So energy will be varying like this. Okay. So taking this reference and also considering that the two Fermi levels will be aligned when the contacts are made, you can draw the energy Venn diagram, complete energy Venn diagram across the junction. Okay. All of you, if you have any question, please feel free to ask. Anybody, if any question, any doubt, then please feel free to ask. Is it clear to all of you? Okay, so shall I go ahead now? So here is let us explore this work function in more detail. Okay, so for n-type semiconductor material, the energy band diagram is you can see this is energy band diagram of n-type semiconductor material, and the EV layer here. Valence band, conduction level here, EC, EI in between, EF is here, and this is ER, reference level. Okay, so ER is the reference level, and therefore the electron affinity or the work function, both will be measured taking this as a reference here. So electron affinity here, Q time chi, you can see this is the difference between the ER minus EC. So reference level to the edge of the conduction band from affinity, okay, and from reference level to the Fermi level, this is called the work function Q time phi ws. Okay, it is multiplied by Q because we are measuring the energy here, and phi ws is a potential. Okay, and since it's n-type donor type impurities are there, so Fermi level has gone upward, okay, is above the EI level, and Q phi f is the Fermi potential in this. Phi f is the Fermi potential, Q phi f can say the difference between EF and EI. Okay, so if we have to define the work function for this silicon, okay, for this n-type silicon, then we can define this phi ws in terms of chi, in terms of eg band gap, and in terms of phi f. Okay, for example here, if I mean we can write down this expression of phi ws. So if I have to write down the potential here, phi ws in terms of chi, so phi ws is nothing but chi, the first term, electron affinity, plus this half of the band gap. This half of the band gap, this chi plus this Eg by 2q, chi plus Eg is the band gap of the material by 2q. So Eg by 2q is basically half of this forbidden gap, or half of this band gap. Up to this point we have this, and now we have to subtract this q phi f, so that we'll get this q phi s, because you see that q phi s is from here to here, and chi plus eg by 2q is from this point to this point. Okay, so if we'll subtract q phi f from here, we'll get the phi f from chi plus eg by 2q. I will get the work function of a p-type semiconductor material. And what will be the work function if p-type semiconductor, this is for n-type semiconductor material. What is the work function if n-type semiconductor material is a degenerate one? Very high. If degeneracy is there in the semiconductor material, we get a simplified expression for this phi ws. Anybody suggest me in case of highly doped type semiconductor material, let us call it N plus plus because doping is very high. What could be the 5Ws? Feel free to ask. Feel free to, yeah.
It can be equal to phi minus this psi f.
Pardon? QG part. EG by 2 Q part.
Yes, sir.
I told you that the degeneration of this EF level goes very close to AC. Okay. Our EF will go to very close to EV in P-type semiconductor material. Okay, so here we are dealing with N-type semiconductor material. So since EF goes very close to EC, then in that case, phi WS is nothing but we can approximate it as a chi electron affinity. Because now this EF has reached to this level, and the Wharf function is nothing but the difference between ER and EF. So this is this Wharf function phi ws here can be approximated as chi if we are considering N plus plus type semiconductor where it is so heavily doped that it has become a degenerate one. Okay, and in the same line, what could be the expression for the Wharf function of a p-type semiconductor material? For a p-type semiconductor material, can I write down the expression for phi WS? Anybody? Any suggestion? So in p-type semiconductor case, the Fermi level will be below the CI, and then it could be, let's say, somewhere here. Okay, somewhere here. This is your phi f, then and phi f. So what will be the Wharf function then? Phi WS? Phi WS is plus EG by 2Q. EG by 2Q. Phi F. Plus Phi F. Because now the for a p-type material, the Fermi level has this EI level, okay? And there is a difference between EC and EI is EG by 2Q. So, and this difference between ER and EC is chi. So chi, this is chi, this gap, basically EG by 2Q. Of. Okay, so the Wharf function for a p-type semiconductor material turns out to be chi electron affinity EG by 2Q half of the band gap plus phi of the flat band voltage. The expressions are similar for both p-type and n-type. The only difference is for p-type case we have plus phi of here, and for n-type case we have minus phi of here. How the expression gets modified if the p type is a degenerate one? The phi ws, if the p type semiconductor material is a degenerate one.
Chi plus eg.
Chi plus eg. Very good. Okay. Because in this case, the Fermi level EF will touch this EV, and therefore chi plus EG will be the Wharf function of the p-type semiconductor material. Okay, so now we have discussed how to find out the Wharf function of p-type and n-type semiconductor materials, and we can use this and we can investigate a p-n junction a little bit, because now we know how to get potential. Okay, so I'm considering the case of a p-n junction. Basically, rather than having a p-n junction, I have taken here a np junction. Okay, deliberately. So the N type semiconductor material is here, and it is there is a P type semiconductor material. We have a junction here. Across the junction, some a particular this region of N type and this region of the P types gets depleted. So there is a depletion region formed here. So at the contact across this depletion region, a potential difference will be seen because of those the region that we have discussed earlier, because of the carrier's movement from P side to N side and N side to P side. Okay, so a built-in potential is set up across the junction here. So just see here, we are considering the energy band diagram of the two regions separately when they are not brought in the contact. When the N region and P regions were separate, they were not in contact. So in that case, the EC, this is N side region and this is P side region. So for N side, the EC, EV, EI, and the Fermi level is here. And for the P side, you can see that EC level is here, and EI, EV layer is here, and EFP, the Fermi level, is below this EI. Generally, in a PN junction, we make it P plus N junction. Okay, so this gap here, call it Q time phi FP, means the Fermi potential of the P side. This gap is basically Q time phi FN. So since generally a P type will have higher doping than the N side, this Q phi P will be greater than this Q phi N. Okay, anyway, this Q phi P, this Fermi potential here is below this EI level, and to the N side, it will be above this EI level. Okay, so now when the two materials will brought in the close contact, we can say that the carriers will move from the N side. Electrons, of course, will move from N side to P side, and from the similar region, you will see that hole will move from P side to N side. As I said, that the electronic energy upward in increases in this direction, whereas the hole energy increases in this direction. Okay, so electron will be moving from N side to P side, and the hole will be moving from P side to N side. So if electrons are moving from N side to P side, then basically N side becomes positive, P side becomes negative, and therefore there will be a variation seen when we move across the depletion region. You can see that since N side is at a higher potential than the P side, so the potential difference is going to be like this. Okay, the variation across the junction is going to be very like this. Only in the depletion region, and since depletion is this N side is higher, at higher potential, P side is at the lower potential. So this is our potential variation. And as I said, that if you know the potential variation, you can also plot the variation of the energy level. Just reverse this. So if the potential variation is like this, then the energy variation is going to be like this. Okay, just in opposite manner. And this contact potential, if this is a contact potential, let's say phi 1 2, when we move from material 1 to 2, when we move from material 1 is basically N type silicon, 2 is P type silicon. So when we move from material 1 to 2, from N side to P side, then basically you will see that the energy level is going to be vary like this, from lower level to higher level, because potential here is higher and lower this side. So energy will be lower this side and higher this side. Okay, so let's say that this is the EC level. So with EC level, you can also plot EV level. EV level will be following this EC level, and also the EI level comes in the middle of this EC and EV level. So here it is EI level, and of course two materials are brought in close contact. Okay, after certain time, when the equilibrium is established, then there will be no net movement of the carriers, and therefore the Fermi levels remain constant throughout the crystal. So throughout the device. So this is the constant Fermi level from N side to P side. Okay, and you see that this gap this is N side. So Fermi level here is above the intrinsic Fermi level, and this is P side. So Fermi level here is below EI level. Okay. So now it's very easy to compute the contact potential here. The contact potential in a PN junction is also called the built-in potential, junction potential. Okay, so built-in potential in this case our contact potential phi 1 2 when we move from region 1 to 2. So it is of course equal to the work function of region 2 minus the work function of region 1. Region 2 is a p-type material, and work function means we have already written the expression for the work function of the p-type material, which was chi plus eg by 2q plus phi f. So let's say for p side it is phi f p minus chi minus chi plus e by 2q plus phi f n for the n side. So chi cancelled out, eg by 2q cancelled out. What we have is phi 1 2 is phi f t plus phi f n. Okay, and expression for phi f p and phi f n are already discussed. For p type semiconductor material, if the doping level is known, then phi f p is nothing but it is phi t natural log of n a upon n i. And for n type material, it is phi t natural log of n d upon n i. So minus minus plus is become phi 1 2 is phi t natural log of n a n d upon n I square. So this is the contact potential in a PN junction, which is also called the built-in potential VVI. VVI is equal to phi t natural log of N A N D upon N I square. So using the concept of contact, we can actually very easily determine the magnitude of the contact potential by using this formula. Phi n2 equal to phi w2 minus phi w1. Moving from 1 to 2 is work function of 2 minus work function of 1. So this is one of the example I have demonstrated here, which is based on our discussion on the contact concept. Okay, you can see that how the contact potential concept is applied in case of PN junction, and we got the built-in potential or contact potential very easily. Okay, in case of PN junction. And here, by the way, the built-in potential or contact potential is this phi 1 2 is the whole bending here. Phi 1 2 is this whole bending. So if you catch either EC or EB or EI, in all cases, basically, the this bending is equal to the built-in potential. Okay. So this is very interesting, and you'll see that this is very widely used because there will be will encounter most often different kind of contexts. Okay. So very useful concept. Just the extension of the concepts we have discussed a little bit earlier is this, where we are having multiple contexts. Let's say that this is a hypothetical device where there are n number of materials starting from M1 to Mn, and they are connected back to back. Okay, so we have n minus 1 number of junction. We have one junction here, two, and the junction number n minus 1 here. Okay, so we have junctions here. So if I try to find out the contact potential between the metal M1 and M2, M1 and Mn, the overall contact potential when I move from M1 to M2 to finally Mn. So it is a very simplified expression, phi M1 Mn, phi W Mn, the work function of the last material here, nth material, minus the work function of the first material. Okay, the work, the total contact potential here, if there are many subsequent junction and you want to measure the potential, contact potential between the two outer terminal, so it turns out to be the work function of the last material minus work function of the first material. Okay, and the work function of the internal materials will actually cancel out each other. So if you look at this junction, then it turns out to be phi M2 minus phi M1. Okay, then if we look at this junction, it turns out to be phi M3 minus phi M2. Okay, and then phi M4 minus phi M3. You go on like this, and then you add the total contact potential, all the intermediate terms will be cancelled out, and we are left with this, the work function of the last material, phi Mn, minus the work function of the first material, which is phi M1. Okay, if there are multiple contacts, then this is the total contact potential between when you move from first material to the nth material. Okay, this is very, very important and very interesting. You can see that there are significant, I mean, there is a interesting question here based on that concept. Okay, just see here that there are the similar arrangement where there are n number of materials connected back to back. Okay, so M1, Mn here. In this case, what I'm doing, I'm not theoretically computing the contact potential, rather I am trying to measure the contact potential with the help of a voltmeter. Okay, so I am using a voltmeter here to measure the contact potential between M1 and Mn. Contact potential, which is a physical thing, so I'm trying to measure that with the help of a voltmeter. Okay, so voltmeter has two probes. So this is a metal probe, which is also a conducting metal probe, you can say, with let's say that the two are made of the same material. So let's say that their work function are mu. Okay, is the work function of the probe of the voltmeter, and the second probe also has a work function of mu. Okay, so what I will get? Can I measure the contact potential? Contact potential, because now in this case, the first metal is this first, the probe of this voltmeter, and the last metal is the second probe of the voltmeter. Okay, so here the work function is phi mu, and for this again the work function is basically, you can say, phi mu. So phi mu, the work function of the last material minus work function of the first material, so it turns out to be zero. I cannot measure the contact potential with the help of a voltmeter. Okay, and you can just consider the case of a p-n junction diode. In a p-n junction diode, which is in equilibrium when there is no externally supplied applied voltage, so there is a p-n junction here in across the so at this junction, across this junction, if this is, let's say, n-type p-type, there is a potential difference here created across the junction. So can I measure this? If I can measure this, then I can also use this for certain application. But with the help of a voltmeter, The answer is again no, because you see that there will be one more junction here, metal contact, N region, then metal contact. So we have here a terminal which is our let's say N, cathode terminal or the N end of the PN junction, and there is another metal here, so which is a metal semiconductor contact, and terminal is going out. So this is, to facilitate this terminal, we must have a metal semiconductor contact here. So let's say that this is anode terminal and this is the cathode terminal. Okay, so if I try to measure this contact potential here with the help of a voltmeter, then again the similar problem will appear here. Let's say that the work function of this probe of this metal, the work function of the first probe is phi m, and the work function of the second probe is also phi m. What will happen? The work function, each work function will cancel out each other. Okay, internal. So you see that phi m is here. This is first metal, you can say, and the last metal is again phi m. So the potential seen here, V is equal to basically phi m minus phi m is equal to zero. Therefore, you can see can't measure the built-in potential because the two probe work function will cancel out each other. So when there is a only contact potential,
Sir, could you please once again explain why the work potential of both, sir, from N side to this voltmeter and P side to this voltmeter is phi m, same, sir?
Because there is same metal used now for two probes from voltmeter. Two probe will be coming out. That probe you will connect in the circuit. So two probes will be made of the same material only.
Yes, sir.
Same work function.
Okay. Thank you.
So that's why that will cancel out each other, and nothing can be measured. Okay. But just see this case. If let's say that we have this kind of arrangement, but somehow we have fixed a battery here in between. Okay. A battery is connect is in between, or you can say that there are two stack of metals. One stack is here. Of course, from M1, M2 to this, and another stack is from this to Mn. Between a battery is connected with potential capital V. We try to measure the potential difference between the two outer end with the help of a. So, if you simply try to theoretically compute the contact potential, it turns out to be V to Mn minus phi w m1 of this minus work function of this plus this plus v. Why it is so? Because the work function of m2, m3, m4, m5, mn minus 1 will be cancelled out each other, but there is no such term to cancel out this battery potential. So battery potential will remain as it is plus the work function of the outside material minus the last one minus work function of the first material. Okay, so this is the theoretical contact potential that we can compute. But when again, if you go if you go with a physical measurement using a voltmeter, then again when I connect a voltmeter here, so this voltmeter will be again have two probes, and if the two probes are actually should be the two probes must be similar to each other. So they will have work function of, let's say, phi m here. This will also have a work function of phi m. So in this case, the phi m, this phi m w, phi w m n minus phi w m 1, this will be replaced by phi m minus phi m. Minus phi m. This phi m is the work function of this material. The material of the second probe, and this phi m is work function of this first probe. So this phi m will cancel with this phi m, and what we are left with only V. So if we measure this with the help of a voltmeter, our output is going to be the potential V. V, capital V, is not a not because of contact potential. It is because of an external source which is connected in between. Okay, so nothing is going to cancel it out. If it were a contact potential, then one term will be cancelled out by the subsequent contact potential terms. So the two terms will be cancelled out each other. What is left with only phi. So that's why if you measure this, if you try to measure the potential here between the two outer node in this case, so you are going to find only phi, not as a not v plus phi w m n minus phi w m 1. Is it understood properly by everybody? If any question, please feel free to ask. Anybody, any question? No question. Okay, so let us go ahead. Is it understood by everybody? So now we'll review the contact potential term, review the carrier transport after having discussed the contact potentials and having understood how the junctions actually, the different power functions of the materials in a junction can be used to find out the total contact potential. Now we can move to the carrier transport in a semiconductor. So in this course, basically, we'll be talking about the conventional carrier transport, which is basically drip diffusion carrier transport. In very brief, when we'll be discussing about the short channel effects, I will also discuss about the ballistic carrier transport. Okay. So, however, here let me introduce the concept of drip time diffusion. Although it is already known to you, but do this very quickly. Okay, so to understand the drift concept, what we have drawn here of semiconductor material, a piece of semiconductor material is taken. Let's say that this is a n-type semiconductor, and we have created two contacts here. Contacts are actually used to bias this by this potential capital V. So a potential difference is applied between the two end of this piece of semiconductor, and the length of this semiconductor is L W, and the thickness is D. So I have chosen the term the dimensions deliberately in this fashion. I didn't choose A, B, C because these equations will be directly used for the MOSFET current modeling. So better I thought that I should take the symbols here in line with what we'll be seeing when we'll be talking about MOSFET. So L is basically the length, you can consider the length of the channel of the MOSFET, and let's say the W is the width, and D is the thickness of the depletion layer, you can say, or thickness of the channel, whatever. You see, this is basically a bulk silicon. So a bulk silicon has, of course, three-dimensional material, so three-dimension length, width, and the thickness D. Okay, so this potential V is applied here. It also considered that the electronic density, this is uniformly doped, this sample of the semiconductor is uniformly doped, and the carrier concentration is electrons per centimeter cube, n per centimeter cube, n number of electrons per centimeter cube volume is present here. can find out the total charge inside this sample, okay, inside this semiconductor, and the total charge is nothing but the volume multiplied by the charge density multiplied by the charge. Of each electron is Q, the total number of electrons is N into the volume of the semiconductor. LWD is the volume, so N into LWD multiplied by Q is the total charge Q. So this is the total charge in the semiconductor. Now we can talk about the concept of a transit time. Okay, so transit time concept is here with the help of this picture. Let us say that there are carriers here. Carriers are moving because of the electric field established by this battery. So carriers are moving, and let's say that there is an average velocity of the carriers. Okay, so the time taken by each carrier, this distance L, can be defined as a transit time. Considering that each and every carrier is moving with an average velocity, which is, let's say, the drift velocity of the carrier. So tau, the transit time, is nothing but the length and divided by the velocity of the carrier Vt. So we are considering here that each and although the carrier transport is a complex phenomena, you see that there are carriers moving, carriers are gaining energy from this battery. They will be scattered with lattice phonons, with lattice atoms. They will interact with, there will be carrier is scattering, carrier phonon is scattering. Okay, so they lose energy to the crystal lattice, then again they gain energy, then they move. It's a complicated process, but to simplify the analysis here, the average behavior is considered, and we are considering that each and every carrier of this piece of the material is varying with a average drift velocity Vt, and the carriers are taking a time tau to cross this length L. Okay, they are staying the carriers are staying in this semiconductor for the time tau, because they have to travel the distance L with a drift velocity Vd. So L by Vd is basically the transit time. So if the tau is the transit time, then we can very easily define this current, total current I. So current I can be defined as total charge Q divided by the transit time tau. So I equal to Q by tau. You know that very one of the very basic relations, charge divided by time to compute the current. So I equal to mod Q, the total charge. We are not considering here whether it is a negative charge or positive charge. So mod term, mod is taken, mod Q divided by tau. And mod Q is nothing but NQ LWD charge, electronic charge, charge density multiplied by the volume divided by the transit time L by Vd. Okay, so L terms are cancelled out here. So what we are left with, the total current I is equal to NQ WD into Vd. Note that this WD is width multiplied by depth, thickness, or you can say thickness. So this is the cross section area. Okay, this is the area of one of the outer face. You can say the WD is the area of this face. This is W, this is D. So WD is the area of either this face, you can say, or the face which is hidden here. Okay, so the WD term is here in the total current, as you can see, QWD and QWD into Vt. This is total current. Now you'll see that in context of MOSFET or MOS capacitor, it is more convenient to use the surface charge density, rather than the total charge. So surface charge density is defined as the total charge Q divided by the area of the top surface or bottom surface. Length is L, width is W. So the area of the top surface is basically LW, and the area of bottom surface is also LW. Okay. So when the total charge is divided by this area, L into W, we get the surface charge density, which is noted as Q prime. You'll see that in this course, most of the time we will be talking about charge density, about Q prime rather than Q. So this charge density is the total charge Q divided by the area of the surface, L into W. If you define the surface charge density in this fashion, then we can get here the expression of the we can get the current expression in terms of surface charge density. So first you can see the expression for the surface charge density. Surface charge density here is Q by L into W. Q is nothing but N Q L W D. L into W, L cancel out, W cancel out, L cancel out, W cancel out. So we are left with only NQD, which is actually the surface charge density Q prime. Okay. So now the current can be written in terms of Q prime. Current is basically NQWD into VD. Okay. So now the NQ and D term, N, Q, and D term, these three terms will be replaced by Q prime. So now the current here, you can see the total current is basically this is drip current, is the width multiplied by the surface charge density Q prime multiplied by the drip velocity of the carriers. So W Q prime PD is the total drip current because of the electrons. And you can take here mod Q prime in order to just look at the magnitude of the current. If we overlook the sign of this current, direction of the current, then we can get the total current I equal to W mod Q prime into PD, which is the drift current. Drift current, you see that this expression, drift current expression, can be further modified and could be made in converted into more useful form. So VD drift velocity, you know that the drift velocity is a function of electric field. If you plot here VD, the drift velocity versus electric field, if electric field is less than a critical field is EC, which is 3 into 10 to the power 3 volt per centimeter per case of silicon. So if electric field is less than, if electric field is less than this critical field, then we can say that the VD is proportional to applied electric field E, and VD is equated to, then proportionality constant comes here, that is the carrier mobility multiplied by E. Mu is mobility, you know, it's unit is centimeter square per volt second. Okay, so the drift velocity, considering that the electric field is not very large, so this VD, the drift velocity, can be replaced by mu into E. Mu B here I am taken because I am considering the port in the piece of the semiconductor. We are not considering that the carrier movement is happening at the top surface. The carrier movement here is happening throughout the surface, throughout the bulk of the semiconductor. So this is noted as mu b, because this is bulk mobility multiplied by E. In a semiconductor, the surface mobility mu s is less than the bulk mobility. Okay, because at the surface there are many irregularity and when carrier moves along the surface, they interact with those irregularity, and their movement is restricted significantly. Therefore, their mobility drops significantly compared to when the carrier moves in the bulk. So the surface mobility, so this term is basically the bulk mobility mu b into v. So we can now get the current expression I equal to W by L, which is because E is nothing but V by D. E is the lateral electric field is V by D, not V by L, because L is the channel length. So V by L here, L is the length of the piece of the semiconductor. So here we get W by L into the charge density multiplied by mobility into V. Okay, W by L is the aspect ratio, and this is the origin of, you can see the W by L ratio in the MOS transistor. Okay, in MOS transistor, you when you design circuit using MOS transistors, you are worried about what should be the W by L ratio. Okay, so this is the origin of the W by L ratio. This is, you can see that in drift current expression, this W by L ratio appears. So this event continues, this will stay with this other terms, which will be later modified in context of the MOSFET, but W by L remains as it is. Okay, so W by L is the aspect ratio, which is the width divided by the length of the semiconductor which is being considered. Okay, so this expression can also be represented in a more general form. So potential here, this is V is basically externally applied potential, and L is length. So this can be generalized, and the current I here can be also written as in general form W mu B mu B Q prime, and V by L is basically replaced by del psi by del x. That is basically the gradient in the potential along the length direction. Okay, so this is the drift current expression here that can be used to get the conductivity, conductance, resistivity, resistance, and also the seat resistance, which is a very, very important term in the context of semiconductor devices, can also be derived with the help of this expression. So let us stop here today. We will continue this discussion in next class. There we'll define the seat resistance, and we'll discuss the importance of the seat resistance, and then we'll talk about the other carrier transport mechanism, which is diffusion. Okay, so I will stop here today. If you have any question, please feel free to ask. Okay, anybody, any question based on our discussion, today's discussion or our discussion so far? Questions?